Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. Brilliant is offering a 30-day free trial and 20% off an annual premium subscription when you sign up at brilliant.org/scishow. We've all been there. You're driving around a packed parking lot looking for a space when you see someone walking out to their car. You think your timing couldn't be better. You're so lucky that they are leaving right as you are arriving. You put on your turn signal as soon as they open the door, and then you wait and wait. Just when you're about to bail to look for another spot, they finally leave. Why did that take so long? Believe it or not, it's classic human territoriality. We feel ownership of certain spaces even when those spaces are not actually ours. And that kind of behavior ranges from silly things like clinging to a parking spot to actions with more serious consequences. So naturally, scientists have studied the heck out of it. Here are some truly ridiculous things that people do in the name of defending their turf. People have been known to act territorially in a lot of different situations, so let's start with a few fairly harmless ones. That scenario I described to you in the parking lot is real. You know it, I know it. But people with PhDs needed data to show that the person in the parking spot really does take longer to leave when you are waiting. They timed 200 people from the moment they got into their cars to the sweet peel out of that coveted spot. Some of them were all alone throughout the process, while others had another car roll in and wait for them to get going. The researchers found that when you're waiting for a parking spot, people stay in that spot an average of 6.88 seconds longer than they do when nobody's waiting. Yes, it's only a matter of seconds, and no, people generally weren't waiting all afternoon. In fact, all departure times were under 2 minutes, with some people leaving in just 10.61 seconds. But this just highlights how deeply every tick of your watch digs in when you're sitting there desperately hoping that this person will finally leave your spot. In publishing these results, the researchers even noted that this doesn't make any sense because you both have the same goal. The first person got into their car with the goal of leaving. When the second person arrived with the goal of finding a parking spot, those two people should have been totally aligned. Instead, the first person turned against everyone's interests, including their own, because suddenly the parking spot became a hot commodity. Nobody said this was logical, they just said it's territorial. And honking will not help. Don't even try it. People generally take 11.95 seconds longer to leave when you honk. At least we're self-aware, though. When filling out a questionnaire, people generally said that they'd take their sweet time leaving a spot if the person waiting honked. The only thing that might help is, drumroll please, having a fancy car? People who drove new, clean luxury vehicles were considered high status in this study, while people who drove older, rusty sedans or station wagons got thrown into the low status category. Not that there's anything wrong with an old, reliable car, it's just, like, not gonna get the guy in the parking spot in gear. Literally. Bizarrely, drivers of high-status cars seemed to shoo away the person in the parking spot an average of 9.33 seconds sooner than drivers of low-status cars. But only if the person in the spot was a man. I know, this is a huge stereotype that men care about pretty cars more than other people, but statistically, women didn't leave any faster or slower based on what vehicle was waiting. So if you happen to be waiting for a parking spot in a high-status car and the person occupying that spot happens to be the average man as sampled in this study, you might not bear the brunt of this absurd territorial behavior. But you will still probably experience territoriality elsewhere, like when you need to use a phone, or at least you would have experienced this a few decades ago when people used payphones. Back in 1989, researchers monitored how long a person stayed on a payphone if they knew that someone was waiting to use it next. People babbled for an extra 3 minutes when someone else was around, and when two people were waiting, they tacked on another 2 minutes compared to when one person was waiting. But let's say you don't spend much time at payphones these days. Maybe you're more of a library person. Never fear, there's a territoriality situation for you too. When you're strolling through the stacks looking for your next murder mystery or autobiography, you'd probably rather peruse the aisles alone. At least you would have that preference if you're anything like the people who filled out the researchers' questionnaire on the topic. But a study in the journal Social Psychology Quarterly concluded that people tend to stand their ground in a library aisle if someone else is there. So now they're not alone for a longer period of time and nobody's happy. On average, when people were alone, they spent 2.17 minutes searching through the titles in an even aisle. And when another person joined joined them in that aisle, they spent an average of 14.66 minutes there. So whether it's a few extra seconds in a parking lot or 12 whole minutes in a library aisle, that's a whole lot of time spent being petty. But I know, it's not pure pettiness. These territorial behaviors are all about defending desirable resources. And that could have more serious consequences than standing around in a library. Sometimes people will undermine entire organizations with their territoriality. When you feel like you need to guard resources like tips and tricks to complete a project efficiently, you're not just wasting your own time, you're influencing how well your company functions. Anytime you have resources like information, salary, or career development opportunities, you have the option to keep them to yourself or to share them. And the territorial way to go about these things would be guarding these resources from your coworkers. Generally, a supervisor sets the tone for what's acceptable behavior at your job. And their territoriality can make a direct report feel like an outsider, which can make them more territorial too. When you don't feel like you belong or that the company isn't sharing information, it's natural to get more guarded. And one study on companies in China found that all of this happens more in competitive workplaces, which makes sense. They have a way of making people more guarded. So if you're looking to make your office less collaborative and a hotbed for territorial behavior, you're gonna want to instill a real competitive, secretive climate around there. Otherwise, maybe don't. Of course, the consequences of human territoriality get much more serious. It goes without saying that war is a highly undesirable result of this instinct. But when we're talking about less destructive behaviors, there are a couple of different kinds of territory that lead to them. When you post a sign that says, "Stay off my lawn," you may be a grumpy old man, but at least you have every right to defend what is called your primary territory. That's your house. The weird part is how you feel territorial about what researchers call secondary territories, spaces that aren't really yours. In a secondary territory, you only have temporary rights, but for that short period of time, you are the exclusive user of that space. Like in the parking lot scenario, you might feel so territorial about a parking spot that you stay there even when you're done using it. But a parking spot, it's a public space. You only have temporary possession of it, and that's enough to make you feel territorial. It's easy to see why the lines between your primary territory and your secondary territory are sometimes blurry. A study conducted in Colorado suggested that since your car is a primary territory that you own, you might extend that thinking to the secondary territory of the road it is on. After all, how many times have you said, "They cut into my lane," when in fact, that's not your lane. It's a public road paved with taxpayer dollars that anyone is free to drive on. But the stronger you feel about your car being your territory, the more likely you are to exert that territoriality over the road as well. Researchers had drivers fill out self-reports of their car decorations and aggressive driving habits, and they found that cars with more personalization, like bumper stickers, which the study defined as a kind of territoriality, reported being more aggressive on the road. And no, it doesn't matter if the bumper sticker has an aggressive message, really. They had cars in their sample population with bumper stickers that said, "Dropkick, insert candidate here," and they were just as aggressive as the people driving cars that merely had that presidential candidate's name on a bumper sticker. When you think about it, all of the early examples in this video were secondary territories, just like the pavement beneath your wheels. Libraries were created for public use. So when you're studying in like a one-person carrel at the library, that's not really your area. But when you go to the restroom and a researcher comes and sits in that carrel that you were using, you probably are going to get territorial over it. And no, this study was clearly not designed for scientists with social anxiety, but it was a real experiment conducted in Virginia. When students came back from the restroom to find a researcher sitting in their spot, they'd go so far as to ask for it back. And in our society, of course they did. Someone was in their spot. But again, that's a public space. It's only their secondary territory. And on some level, people understand that, because students who had been sitting at long tables at the same library were more likely to just return to a different seat at that table and not confront the researcher who had usurped their spot. The researchers think the difference between territory defenders and people who submit to having their secondary territory taken over comes down to how valuable the seat is. A single occupancy carrel is more likely to be defended territory than a multi-person table because that's a high-value seat. Interviews with the students backed that up. They confirmed that students prefer to get their study on in a carrel. Just like the parking spot, when you recognize that what you have is something others want, you might get territorial over it. But we don't always act like this. A study conducted in Canada was specifically designed to replicate the parking lot study in the bathroom. After all, a stall in the water closet is an equally valid secondary territory. It definitely feels like yours when you are using it. But as it turns out, the loo can't be used in lieu of any other secondary territory. In this study, there was no significant difference between how long someone spent in a stall when there was a line versus no line. And thank the Lord for that. Like, at least we have that going for us. If anything, the data trended toward wrapping up faster when there was a line. Maybe it's because we're, like, good people? But we have to do due diligence here to look into the nuance of this study. For example, they only timed people in women's washrooms because they generally use stalls. Apparently, urinals don't have as clear territorial boundaries, so who knows if the same results would show up in a more representative sample. But it might just be that this territory isn't super desirable. Like, sitting in a public bathroom isn't quite the same experience as sitting in your car with the butt-warming seats turned on and the Foo Fighters blasting out of your speakers. And as we learned from the Library Carol experiment, how desirable a territory is determines the likelihood that you will defend it. So we are territorial in all sorts of spaces, but it's not terribly productive. Maybe after watching this video, you'll have the same compassion for someone looking for a parking spot that you might show in the potty. Now these days, when you're sitting on the toilet, it's pretty common to be scrolling. Those bathroom breaks are getting longer and longer as we mindlessly scroll the day away. Heck, you might have stumbled upon this video that very way. But how many of the videos you watch through the scroll method are like SciShow, providing you with fact-checked scientific information that makes you smarter and more curious? And how many of them provide interactive learning opportunities like what you would find at brilliant.org/SciShow? When you're more intentional about how you spend your time online, you can fit in more SciShow episodes and learn a little every day with Brilliant. Brilliant helps you build knowledge in just minutes, so you can establish healthier habits than doom scrolling and instead spend your time learning from credible sources like professionals from Microsoft, MIT, Google, and Caltech instead. I mean, if you're already spending that time crushing virtual suites, why not complete puzzles that help you learn science, computer science, and math concepts? Brilliant offers a huge variety of puzzles, case studies, and other unique ways to help you engage with new topics. And the topics themselves are wide-ranging, from measurement to coding to probability. There's something for everyone at brilliant.org/scishow. To get started, you can type in that URL or click the link in the description down below. That link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free. Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video.